afternoon, everyone. We are the Mind Tracker Group. My name is Gab.
I'm Joey.
That is
Gianni.
Justin.
The U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics has considered the mine industry to be one of the most dangerous. Annually, we have 30 deaths a year, every time. And this is due to the environment. And it's not just limited to the collapsing walls or dust explosions. This also mainly has to do with toxic gases, especially methane. There's sulfur dioxide, and there's also carbon dioxide. These dangers are always plaguing the workers, not just in the U.S., but also globally. So here's a list of three of the most catastrophic events that have occurred throughout the world in between the years of 2006 and 2010. The first one is, it occurred in Mexico in 2006 in the Pasta de Conchos coal mine. This was due to a methane explosion. And as a result, 65 mine workers died. Next, we have the Sable coal mine disaster, which occurred in West Virginia in the year of 2006. 12 mine workers were trapped, and none of them survived. Lastly, we have the Upper Big Branch coal mine disaster. Again, it occurred in West Virginia, but in the year of 2010. This was due to a methane explosion and resulted in the death of 29 mine workers out of 30. So the goal of our group is to provide a solution to give workers more safety. This includes implementing a tracking system and proper communication. Now, yes, communication systems already exist, and the problem is that they are not wireless. And when we have wires in our system, this results in more explosions, especially if a wire breaks and is exposed to methane.
A lot of the research that our group used were a lot of documentation, a lot of research that we found. The first piece of research that we used was underground mine communications. This document basically discusses the environment of an underground mine and how communication is altered just because it is in such a specific location versus being above ground or in a building. We also looked at a research document discussing wireless communication in underground mines using RFID systems. This was a good temporary solution for underground mine tracking using RFID, and then we also used many online resources. A lot of the findings from our research was showing existing solutions of a lot of older technologies like pager phones, magnetotelephones, carrier current phones. The most used mine communication system is a PED, which is a personal emergency device. This device allows for paging, it sends evacuation warnings, and phone and radio communication back and forth. These are a lot of really good solutions and they work well. However, they don't provide necessarily an exact tracking location of where miners are or where their endpoints are. Another existing solution that mines typically use would just be walkie-talkies, being able to communicate an industry standard walkie-talkie using the Motorola RDU. Just for a package of 12, it costs about $3,600. These walkie-talkies are basically utilized for a maximum range of about 30 floors, meaning that they're made for basically building use for firefighters or for other outdoor industries, not necessarily in an underground mine. Since one of our studies used an RFID system to track miners and other devices within the mine, we added an RFID antenna, which was about $811. This is not a complete system for tracking. This is just the cost of an RFID antenna. It does not include the tags and the wiring. Our goal would be to introduce the Mine Tracker, which is a safety tracking and asset management system. It is comprised of three different components: the miner coordinator, the miner router, and the miner endpoint. We have to implement a system that is compliant with mine safety, with the Mine Safety and Health Administration. This is the overall compliance regulatory authority that the U.S. has to implement safe, secure standards across all different mines. we are expecting this device to have a 30-foot range from router to endpoint, and we wanted to implement a very low-cost solution. This is our estimated cost breakdown depending on three different components. We have a total cost for just a coordinator router and minor endpoint to be a total of about $156, which is much less than the insufficient systems that were shown and that we found in our research. Our topic covers a lot of coal mines, and we narrowed it down to coal mines, which is the 30 deaths per year is only in coal mining industry. This does not include a lot of oil and other types of mining. We used the room and pillar because it has a very useful structure. There's basically empty rooms with walkways and hallways, and it is pretty universal around all coal mines that are underground. So it would be an easy system for us to map and implement. This is this is kind of overlaid over the map, but for some reason it's not displaying. But if you would think of a pillar here, a pillar here, and a pillar here, this is where our routers would be communicating with different endpoints, and they communicate to the coordinator. This is the system overview of our design. It's basically having different layers or different levels of our system have a router, which are the white devices, wired to the coordinator, which is the black device. Each miner or piece of equipment would have an endpoint device, and all of that sends data to the coordinator. An administrator will log into their computer, connect to the coordinator, and track information. Topics that we'll be discussing to kind of take you through the process of our project is hardware, firmware, software, and concluding with our timeline and tasks.
So, Teddy and I will be discussing the hardware design to our project. The tools we decided to use are these three main components. The first one is the Freedom Development Platform, and we will be using four of these in total. One of them will be attached to the coordinator, we will have one on the router, and then we will have two on two separate endpoints. Second, we are using different kinds of sensors. The first kind is the ultrasonic transceiver, and we will be using both a transmitter and also a receiver. Second, we also would like to track the underground mining, monitor underground mining conditions, such as temperature, methane especially, since that causes most of the accidents, sulfur dioxide. Next, we have Zigbee, and this will be used for the wireless data transfer between the router and the coordinator. So here we have a block diagram of our endpoint. It has the system, which is our Freedom Development Platform. It has a communication port through USB. It has an input, which is the power. And for this, we're using a DC battery for the endpoint. We have two indicators, which are LEDs. One of them is the status OK, and the other one is the alarm. Over here, we have DIP switches. We have a user interface button. And this is the button that a mine worker can press if there is something going wrong and the signal gets sent over to the coordinator. And lastly, we have our output, which here will be the ultrasonic transmitter sensor. So here is an overview of our system and why we chose our development platform. The main reason is because it's compatible with Zigbee. And it also contains the Kinetis microcontroller, which, again, is also compatible with Zigbee and uses the IEEE standards that we need. And lastly, because it's powered in several different configurations. The first way this board can be powered is through micro USB type E connector, which provides 5 volts. Second, the development platform's headers, which can provide 3.3 volts or 5 to 9 volts. And this can also be powered through an external DC supply with 3.3 volts minimum and 15 maximum.
Okay, so this is like a detailed schematic of our development board, like Dr. Hussein said before. for this semester, we're going to be focusing on developing the board for next semester and then our own portion for next semester. Our development board, or our actual board, would be very similar to our development board, simply if I could be chosen for our project. So we don't have to really change much, except we're going to add the temperature sensors and the gas sensors to do this upgrade. And we get to that point of chosen. This is our router block diagram. The highlighted portions are, the sections are different than our endpoint. The major ones are the input. We're going to have ultrasonic receiver sensor right here. Our output will be localization data. And our power will be DC-line power or battery power. Most mines have run an AC power, but they convert it to DC power. So because of that, we're going to be focusing on where the DC. For our endpoint, we're going to have a returnable lithium battery. The reason we chose this is lithium batteries are known to have a high charge density, which is a long life. And since we need the endpoint to be connected at all times, we are our router would be powered like most other routers to the power line. Since mines use DC power, we're going to be focusing on DC power. In the case of a power failure or power outage, we're going to have a battery backup. Fortunately, most mines are going to use UPS battery backup for Bitcoin. Their system will act as a battery charge, DC battery storage bank to recharge. And the UL standards would require us to make sure our battery backup powers our system for at least 24 hours. But they include Bitcoin. Charging for at least six to eight weeks, and if we have the optional IQ for cells, it could be self-reliant for several days on the cell. The indicators. For our router, we have the DC power LED with the blue. It's going to indicate whether the system is on or off. The status of the LED is going to be green, in the case when the system is working properly. We're going to have an alarm. The LED is going to be red. If there's a problem, the alarm will be flashing, blinking, and if there's something wrong with it. For the user interface, like most routers, we're going to have a test button and a reset button. The input is not working properly, reset the router, and test the test button. And for the endpoint, we're going to have a stress button, which is similar to what I said before. If there's a problem, it's just a stress button, and it sends a message saying there's a problem.
As I mentioned before, we will be using ultrasonic sensors, both a transmitter and a receiver sensor. And I found this sensor, it's called LVMAP Sonar from the Easy Series. And this can be configured to work as a transmitter, a receiver, or even a transceiver. The transmitter sensor, as I mentioned before, will be attached to the end pump right over here. And this will transmit ultrasonic waves up to 30 feet. Next, we have the receiver, which is attached to the router over there. And this can detect ultrasonic waves that are being transmitted from the endpoint up to 30 feet away. This also operates at 42 kilohertz and a temperature ranging from 0 degrees Celsius to 60 degrees Celsius. And this is great for our mind considering how temperatures can go up to 54 degrees Celsius. These also require 2.5 minimum volts to work and 5.5 maximum. And here, these are the sensor dimensions. As you can see, it's a very small sensor, but it has a beam angle of 62 degrees. So it can detect a lot within 30 feet, which is great. And as I said before, it can be configured to work as a transmitter or a receiver based on the pins that we're using.
This is a coordinated block diagram. The central location, we essentially made it very similar to our block diagram. It's one of the really good things we need to input, so we can route data. The router will collect data from endpoints using an ultrasonic sensor, and it will send and transmit to the coordinator through Zigbee. The reason we chose Zigbee instead of Wi-Fi is because Wi-Fi is more suited for web, email, and videos, but Zigbee is more for automation and commercial sensor networks. Also, the other advantages come with Zigbee is low cost, it's easy to configure, there's a lot of load, static transfer, and it's just easier to
So for firmware, the Zigbee has a lot of built firmware. For the layers, we have the radio layer, the stack HSS layer, the application profile layer. Our modifications are going to be mainly the application profile layer. The Zigbee firmware, pre-built firmware, has a lot of cluster libraries. And in these libraries, they have different profiles for that have different feature sets for different profiles like home automation, smart energy automation, commercial building automation, and manufacturing specific automation. We're focusing on home automation profile and the smart energy profile. From these, we're going to take the range extender and put it on all of our routers. The on and off switch for all of our devices, the configuration tool for our coordinator, the controller indicator one for all our devices, and the thermostat function for the end devices to measure the temperature inside the mic. And from the smart energy profile, we're going to take the gas metering and try to implement the gas sensor, as well as implement a security layer, a network layer encryption amongst all our devices. And the Zigbee firmware has a pre-built location triangulation feature, which we're going to use for localization to display the different locations of each of our end devices. This is an hour where it takes the location between three of our router devices on a single endpoint. For firmware design tools, we're using the Freescale VKit, which is a configuration tool used to produce wireless projects. It does not have, it needs a IDE. So that's another parameter we're going to use. But the cool thing about it is that it has a test tool for simulating, in which we can actually set up the different coordinators, routers, and end devices with our functions on them, and then test out how they work in an actual home, or just how they work in the home. The Data Studio is a software implementation tool that Zigbee works. So this is the IDE that we are using to compile and debug our framework to put onto the board. And we use a C and C. For communication testing, we're going to be using the Zigbee Lightning profile, which essentially just has two boards communicating with each other and showing LED functions on either board.
For software, our software architecture covers three layers. We have the presentation layer, which has the graphic user interface, which is going to be based off HTML. We have the service layer, which has a data access button. Application, and you have the domain layer, which is the domain services, not just the database. Right here is the start of our graphic user interface. As soon as you log into our application, you see a nice welcome message and it has show credentials you can enter, which is your username and password. And once you log in, you're welcome to the real browser of our application. On the right, you have a panel which displays all the layers of the pod that you're in. And if you click on the layer, it'll highlight that and it'll bring you to there. From that, you see the physical environment of the mod and each node inside the mod. From there is the personnel. Scroll down and select whoever you want to select. It's either the nodes are endpoint devices which are attached to either a person or a PC. And you select them, you can see the different specifications of what different conditions of the endpoint device. So you have the battery life, the temperature, the entry time into the system, and the condition. Blue represents a good condition. It's the basic default that we have on all endpoint devices. Red signals a distress signal. So on the endpoint devices, if say there's a gas explosion or a paper, the personnel and all you have to do is press the distress button on the endpoint device, and on the system it will turn red, signaling that there is a problem in that area. And there's also a blue display that if there's a passing button, which would be detected by router, the display will turn green. And this is pretty much how it would look on the administrator's laptop, where they're looking at the application. And we're going to be using an open source database for our data access.
for our timeline and deliverables, we've created this timetable. We started off doing just preparation research for this project. We developed a proposal and listed our requirement specifications. We divided our development phase into four different sections with firmware development, hardware coinciding. Then we had a software development, and then we have to develop our web application, which is what the administrator will be using to access the location of all of these devices. Our test plan will be based off of our requirement specifications document, ensuring that we met all of our requirements. And as a whole team, we will be developing the documentation and testing the actual device. This is a breakdown of how our team is split up and what different tasks we have doing. I'll be completing most of the project management. Our documentation is covered by our entire team. Software development is mainly Gianni and Justin. Our firmware development will be by Gianni and myself. The web application will be with Justin and myself. Most of the hardware development will be with Teddy and Gabby, and the testing will be done by the entire team. Thank you.
Okay, for the line, we are going to take one question. Anyone?
How are you going to test if the, for instance, you have triangulation to pinpoint where an end user is, right? How do you know if a column of coal does not interfere with your triangulation effort,
for example? Yes, so that's why we're also implementing ultrasonic sensors, so we can use sonar to kind of find a non-moving point from where the router is because it will be stationary. So we'll be having the three devices using Zigbee connection to triangulate where it is, and also using the sonar to ensure that stationary devices like the column, the things like that, are not mapped on our board.
Okay. Thank you. So we have the third group.